हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम टू दी वाइवा वॉस ऑफ एनाटॉमी। हियर आई विल डिस्कस अबाउट द प्रैक्टिकल एस्पेक्ट ऑफ द सब ऑक्सीपिटल ट्राइंगल। नाउ द सब ऑक्सीपिटल ट्राइंगल इज अ पेयर ऑफ मस्कुलर ट्राइंगल सिचुएटेड ऑन ईच साइड ऑफ मिड लाइन इन द सब ऑक्सीपिटल रीजन। द सब ऑक्सीपिटल रीजन इज बाउंडेड अबाउ और लिमिटेड अबाउ बाय दिस इन्फीरियर नकल लाइन, बिलो by the bifid spine of C2 vertebra and the lamina of C2 vertebra, and laterally it is limited by this mastoid process and the lateral process or transverse process of the C1 and the C2 vertebra. Now about the boundary of suboccipital triangle, the superolaterally it is bounded by this superior oblique muscle. You can see this is the superior oblique muscle. Superomedially it is bounded by rectus capitis posterior major muscle, accompanied by this rectus capitis posterior minor muscle, this one, and inferiorly by this inferior oblique muscle. So this is the suboccipital triangle. Inferior oblique muscle arises from the bifid spine of C2 vertebra and inserted here into the transverse process of C1 vertebra. The superior oblique muscle, which arises from the transverse process of C1 vertebra and inserted here into the lateral part of occipital bone between the superior and inferior knuckle line. Now this rectus capitis posterior major arises from the bifid spine of C2 vertebra and inserted to the here lateral part of inferior knuckle line. And this rectus capitis posterior minor arises from the posterior tubercle of C1 vertebra and inserted to the medial part of inferior knuckle line. Now about the roof. The roof is formed by two muscles. Medially is the semispinalis capitis muscle. This is the semispinalis capitis muscle. And laterally by the longissimus capitis muscle. This one is the longissimus capitis muscle. And this longissimus capitis inserted to this mastoid process, and semispinalis capitis inserted to the area of occipital bone here between the superior knuckle line and the inferior knuckle line. And these two muscles are partially covered by this splenius capitis muscle. This is the splenius capitis muscle, longissimus capitis, and this is the semispinalis capitis muscle. Now, inferomedially, this suboccipital triangle is crossed by this greater occipital nerve. It is the thickest nerve of the body, thickest cutaneous nerve of the body. Remember, this greater occipital nerve is the medial branch of dorsal ramus of C2. Now, first it winds round the inferior oblique muscle. Here you can see. Then it passes upwards. Then pierces the semispinalis capitis muscle. Here you can see the greater occipital nerve pierces the semispinalis capitis muscle. Then it ascends upwards and supply the posterior surface of the skull up to the vertex, and it is accompanied by the occipital artery. Now, superolaterally, the roof is crossed by this occipital artery. This occipital artery is the branch of external carotid artery in the carotid triangle. Now, in the carotid triangle, it passes backwards and deep to the posterior belly of digastric muscle, then passes deep to the sternocleidomastoid muscle, then it lodges in a groove behind the mastoid process of temporal bone, then it enters into the suboccipital triangle, here you can see, and lies deep to the longissimus capitis muscle. This is the longissimus capitis muscle, and deep to is the occipital artery. Now it ascends upwards and here it rests over the superior oblique muscle. You can see. Then it further ascends upwards, and later on it is accompanied by this greater occipital nerve. The floor is formed by the posterior arch of atlas vertebra. This is the posterior arch of atlas vertebra, and the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane. This white color is the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane, which extends from the posterior margin of foramen of magnum to the upper border of posterior arch of atlas vertebra here, and it also arches over the vertebral artery. This is the vertebral artery. Now the content of suboccipital triangle. There are three contents. First content is the third part of vertebral artery. Then second content is the suboccipital nerve, and third content is the suboccipital venous plexus. Now about the vertebral artery. This vertebral artery arises from the first part of subclavian artery. Then it enters into the foramen of transversarium of C6 vertebra. Then it ascends upwards through the foramen of transversarium of C5, C4, C3, C2 and C1. Now from the C1, it emerges and appears in the suboccipital triangle. Then it ascends upwards below this atlanto-occipital membrane. Then enters into the cranial cavity through the foramen of magnum after piercing the dura mater and arachnoid mater. Now there are four parts of vertebral artery. So first part, from its origin to the foramen of transversarium of C6. Then second part, from the foramen of transversarium of C6 to the foramen of transversarium of C1. And third part, from foramen of transversarium of C1 to the foramen of magnum. So this third part appears in the suboccipital triangle, and last part, fourth part, in the cranial cavity. Now the suboccipital nerve, which is the second content, which emerges between this vertebral artery and the posterior arch of atlas vertebra. This one you can see, the suboccipital nerve. It is the medial branch of dorsal ramus of C1, and it supplies the inferior oblique muscle, superior oblique muscle, rectus capitis posterior, major and minor muscle, and also supplies this semispinalis capitis muscle. And remember one important thing, the C1 nerve, the dorsal ramus, does not provide any cutaneous supply. Then this greater occipital nerve is the dorsal ramus of C2, and the lesser occipital nerve is the dorsal ramus of C3. Now third content is the suboccipital venous plexus, which is found in or around the suboccipital triangle. Here you can see the venous plexus. This one is the venous plexus. It drains the occipital vein, then transverse sinus through the emissary vein and internal vertebral venous plexus, and finally it drains into the vertebral vein. Now the clinical importance. Cisternal puncture is often done through this triangle to collect the CSF from the cisterna magna, also known as a cerebellomedullary cistern. So in this procedure, the needle is inserted like this, just above the bifid spine of C2 vertebra, and parallel to the imaginary line which passing through the external acoustic meatus and the nasion. Now first this needle pierces the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane, which is indicated by the sudden release of resistance, and too much insertion is also fatal because it leads to injury to the vital structure of medulla. So this is all about the suboccipital triangle. Thank you.
If you like our video, click on the like button and share with your friends. To get the regular updates on anatomy video by Viva Voice of Anatomy, subscribe to our channel and click on the bell icon.